fresh off winning an NBA record 73 games in the regular season and losing a 3-1 lead in the NBA Finals. The Warriors added Kevin Durant. They are the first team in NBA history to have a former MVP under the age of 30 after finishing the previous season with the NBA's best record. Stephen A., did Kevin Durant going to Golden State ruin this regular season?
He did for me. He did for me, and I'm going to be the first to say that. I mean, you got people that feel differently. They're entitled to their ignorance. I am not going that route. Kevin Durant is one of the top three players on the planet. He is his own freak of nature, similar to LeBron. Physical prowess that LeBron is. Let's not forget the fact that Kevin Durant is about 6'10", has a 7'6 wingspan, can pull up from 30, got a handle, can score 30 in his sleep. And this is who was added to the 73-9 Golden State Warriors, who has the greatest shooting backcourt in the history of basketball. This is a guy that will be replacing Harrison Barnes, for crying out loud. Now, I am on the record stating major, major props to the Cleveland Cavaliers. I understand they're the champions. No disrespect whatsoever. But if Draymond Green hadn't gotten suspended for Game 5 or for his kick to LeBron James in Game 4, I personally believe we'd be sitting here talking about the Golden State Warriors as reigning two-time defending NBA champions. So adding Kevin Durant to that equation, I look at what happened in the preseason when they annihilated the Los Angeles Clippers, and I see that as pretty much the norm throughout the regular season. There are nights they will take off. There are nights they will lollygag and take it easy, and Steve Kerr will get mad and he'll punch the chalkboard and hurt his wrist by, you know, cracking the chalkboard in half, and that will be of interest. Outside of that, what we're tuning in for during the regular season is pretty much an annihilation on a pretty much nightly basis. That annoys me. It upsets me. It's not going to stop me from looking forward to the playoffs. But I just look at Golden State right now, and I'm so disgusted because I'm about competitive fervor. I love balance with power, and I don't see that balance really existing, and I am completely disgusted about it, to say the least, because of how it went down. That's where I stand.
You're disgusted about it. Why don't you be honest? Because you got to cover this stuff during the regular season, and the drama's taken out because it's a foregone conclusion. This has not ruined the regular season.
I'm not denying that.
It's ruined the regular season the way the Dream Team ruined the 92 Olympics. First of all, NBA's not about the regular season anyway. We're just watching the stars do their things until the postseason starts. More than half the teams make that anyway. And we all know who's going to be in the Final Four, so to speak, in the NBA and the conference finals. To start the season, we have a pretty good idea who's going to be on the final in the finals, and we usually know who's going to win the finals. So the only difference really this year is we have maybe, on paper at least, the greatest team ever assembled, considering they just won 73 games, and they're essentially replacing Barnes with KD. Did you not like watching the 92 Olympics? Because let me tell you something. Imagine if the Dream Team in the 92 Olympics, instead of in the gold medal round facing a hapless opponent, faced the Redeem Team with LeBron in them. Because that's what's going to happen ultimately in the finals, a rubber match. They split the last two. All these questions between two super teams. Is the regular season a foregone conclusion? Yes, that's not what the NBA is about, number one. And number two, you get to watch this
first of all, that would be easy for somebody to say who's usually covering boxing in the ringside in Vegas on a Saturday night, as opposed to somebody who has to travel to cover these games for 82 games a year. That's number one. Number two, and more importantly, Max Kellerman, you keep bringing up the Dream Team. Well, guess what? This would be very, very exciting had the Dream Team never existed. But we've seen that act before. And because we've seen that act before, I'm not interested in seeing it again. Damn it, I wasn't interested in seeing it that much back in 1992 after the first few games against Angola and a few other teams. I knew what was going to go down. It was exciting initially, but then it wore off relatively quickly. That's not the case. We have to endure it through November, December, January, February, March, April, and then the playoffs are about to begin, and it's even lopsided come playoff time. I'm going to repeat this. It's not about the fact that you just have a team. It's about the fact that one of the top three players on the planet, as far as I'm concerned, is up 3-1 in the Western Conference Finals, loses Game 5, relatively chokes in Game 6, loses in Game 7, and then goes to the team that beat him. Okay, that is what I listen, I'm not trying to be disrespectful. I'm speaking to the greatness of Kevin Durant. This dude is so great. When you combine him with Steph Curry, and one of the greatest shooters we have ever seen, by the way, in Klay Thompson, who is no joke. The fact of the matter is, it's like playing horse in the park,
it's
man.
It's not a testament to KD's greatness. This is actually a testament to LeBron James's greatness. That's why this is not about the regular season. When Mike Tyson was in his prime, those little fights, I mean, Buster Douglas upset him, but people wanted to see him fight Holyfield eventually.
It's
Ali, Frazier,
it's
Mayweather,
not the same.
Pacquiao.
It's not the
that's
same.
What, Sugar Ray Leonard, Marvin
listen,
Hagler.
Listen.
LeBron James' greatness is the reason that KD had to join a 73-win team.
I get annoyed when you use the boxing analogy all the time, because here's the deal. Mike Tyson was knocking dudes like Michael Spinks out in 91 seconds or Marvin Frazier in 22 seconds. I got to deal with 48 minutes a night for 82 games. I mean, this is not funny.
Yeah.
It is not funny.
Guess what? We have to deal with the depressed Stephen A.
Come on.
That is true.
South
you can't stop him early in the NBA.
All right, if the Cavs and Warriors face off in the finals, it'll be the first time the same two teams have faced each other in the finals for three straight years. Now, speaking of the Cavaliers, the defending champion team, they're entering the season as prohibitive favorites to win the Eastern Conference at 1-4. The next closest team, the Boston Celtics, at 8-1. So the question is, who is the biggest threat to LeBron James making it to his seventh consecutive NBA Finals?
I mean, the real answer is injury or the Cavs themselves.
Yeah.
Because the fake answer is the Boston Celtics. I mean, if the question is who's the second best team in the East, I suspect it'll be the Celtics. They're on the way up. They have a great young coach in Brad Stevens. They add Al Horford, who, when you really think about the way the modern NBA game is played, there are only a handful of bigs who play it just the way you want at the five, at the four or the five. And Al Horford's one of them. You know, you think of Draymond Green for Golden State. You think Karl Anthony Towns will be a super Draymond Green eventually and already may be in the discussion among the elite this season. And Horford actually belongs in that kind of group. He can do just about all the things you want a big to do. You add that to a team that while they did, look, Horford's not the kind of guy who's going to dominate a playoff series. But you add that component to a team that was looking to get over the top, and it doesn't get them over the top in terms of the Cavs, obviously. But it probably gets them over the top compared to the rest of the Eastern Conference.
Well, that's not a bad pick. I'm proud of your analogy. Didn't know you knew that much about basketball, but I will tell you this. I'm still not willing to go that far. I don't underestimate it. I'm a fan of Brad Stevens. I love me some Isaiah Thomas. I'm not as enamored with the pickup of Al Horford as much as everybody else is. But I will say this. I'm not underestimating or sleeping on the Indiana Pacers. Jeff Teague, point guard out of Atlanta, picked up by Larry Bird in the offseason. That's a huge acquisition because, listen, we all like George Hill and what have you and what he brought to the table because he had a lot of guts, he could hit big shots and whatever, but he wasn't your quintessential prototypical point guard. Jeff Teague has proven to be a quality point guard in this league. He desperately wanted out of Atlanta. He got what he wanted. Paul George is a star. And remember that last year, even after averaging 23 points a game, he was coming off that nasty injury. Now he's got a year under his belt, plus he participated in an Olympic competition. He'll be ready to go, okay? Listen, I look at all of those things, and I look at Miles Turner, who's shown promise as well. I look at CJ. I think about him. I think of what he brings to the table, CJ Miles. I'm just saying, Paul George, that backcourt, that experience with the new coach, Nate McMillan, now in play as well. I think all of those things bode well for Indiana. I'm not going to sit up there and poo-poo the Boston pick. I'm not going to sleep on my Knicks because I'm hoping they will show up. But I will tell you that in this day and age, in this game, when you are locked in with a damn good backcourt that can produce for you on both ends of the floor, I don't underestimate the impact of that. Isaiah Thomas in Boston, you still have an identity issue with the Boston Celtics when they start him as a point because he's really better off the ball than he is on the ball in a lot of people's eyes.
I disagree with that.
But I'm just saying, in a lot of aficionados' eyes, he is better off the ball. They play with him shooting as opposed to running the show. They play better that way. But Jeff Teague, no one questions what he is as a point guard.
I agree. I was surprised at how easy it was for them to pick up Teague. But I want to say something about Isaiah Thomas because it pertains to my Boston pick. Isaiah Thomas has always been underrated. He signed right now to a deal under $7 million a year, which was insane when the Suns stole him for that money. He's an excellent offensive player who's an underrated decision maker with the ball. I want to say that. Also, speaking of backcourts, you can't sleep on Toronto. Masai Ujiri is an excellent GM. As soon as he left Denver, their fortunes went straight down.
Hold on.
And the Raptors can't
be swept. Don't go all over there. The point is, you said Boston. And I'm telling you, when it comes to decision-making, Isaiah Thomas is questionable.
Underrated.
Offensively, he's big time. He can put the ball in the hole. He can make big shots. Decision-making, even the Boston Celtics concede. At times, it's problematic with him and Avery Bradley in the lineup. That's a fact.
Hello again. We're going to play a little game of NBA fact or fiction. Here's how it works. I'm going to read you a line, and you tell me if it's fact or fiction. Are we ready, gentlemen?
Let's go.
Let's do it. Westgate has set the Clippers over-under at 54.5 wins, third most in the Western Conference behind the Warriors and Spurs. Max Kellerman, fact or fiction, the Clippers will play in the Western Conference Finals this season.
Fact, and I'll tell you why. Doc Rivers will not allow this era to pass without at least a Western Conference Finals appearance. This is his best chance this year. CP3 and Blake, both top 10 players, DeAndre an all-star, and the Western Conference, because Durant going to the Warriors and Duncan's retirement is a little weaker. This is the year they do it. They lose to the Warriors in the Western Conference Finals.
As much as I hope you're right, I'm going to call it fiction because I have to see it to believe it. Blake Griffin, this has got to be his year. Him and Chris Paul can opt out and be unrestricted free agents this summer. They certainly will be motivated to prove themselves. DeAndre Jordan has to hit free throws. And even though you've got a lot of guards, Raymond Felton is there now, the backup of Chris Paul. Austin Rivers is still there. Mbai Mbute, he's going to be there. Him and Rivers are defensive guys that struggle offensively from time to time. I'm not sure about that. I look at the Spurs acquiring Pau Gasol, who's a better version than what Tim Duncan was last year, along with David Lee, who can do some things as well, keeping the rest of the nucleus in place with Kawhi Leonard and LaMarcus Aldridge. I'm going to say the Spurs. I'm going to give them the edge to meet Golden State in the conference finals rather than the Clippers right
Spurs
now.
Spurs still vulnerable to young athletic teams. We saw it last year.
All right, let's talk about your Knicks, gentlemen. With the additions of Derrick Rose and Joakim Noah, Westgate set the over-under wins for the Knicks at 40.5, which is ninth best in the East. Fact or fiction, the Knicks will win a playoff series this year. Stephen A.
I'm going to say fact. I'm going to go with it because I'm putting the pressure on Carmelo Anthony to deliver the goods. He is a superstar offensive player in this game when he is healthy. You've got Kristaps Porzingis, who's a 7'1" scorer and very, very capable. You added veterans in Joakim Noah and Derrick Rose. Courtney Lee, although I would have preferred Dwayne Wade, Courtney Lee is still a damn good player. When I look at all of those things into consideration, along with Hornacek, convincing Phil Jackson, you don't have to use the triangle all the time. This should be the year the Knicks can win a playoff series similar to what Mike Woodson did about 3 or 4 years ago.
Fiction, the make the playoffs, they won't win a series. The problem is timing. Porzingis is not yet in his prime. Carmelo is exiting his. Derrick Rose can't shoot. Good thing they have Courtney Lee, because in a couple years, that contract's not going to look so great. But right now, he can shoot and defend, which is what they need. But the pieces aren't going to come together at the right time for the Knicks for them to take that next step or two steps and not only make it, but win a series this year.
Tough for you to say. Stephen A. trying to speak it into existence. Last one, James Harden moving to point guard and is now playing for Mike D'Antoni. Fact or fiction, is it a good idea for the Rockets to move Harden to point guard? Max.
Yes. First of all, Mike D'Antoni knows offense. He knows how to use his offense. When he has a muse, even if it's like, forget about Steve Nash, a Jeremy Lin, he can make great things happen offensively. And James Harden's really the point guard anyway. He's the primary ball handler. The offense runs through him. So the difference is D'Antoni will get him to make quicker decisions, get rid of the ball quicker. It'll make Harden a better player.
I think Harden's already a superstar in this league. He already averaged 7.5 assists last year. But I would say fiction. I don't think it's a good move because D'Antoni doesn't prioritize defense. He's going to prioritize more offense. And I think that in Houston, with James Harden being the man, as opposed to what he was in Oklahoma City beforehand, I think he's addicted to having the ball and shooting when he wants. And that's never, ever good for a point guard. I do not believe that would be to his benefit.
Point guard, that role has changed over the years. Many more penetrating, scoring first point guards nowadays. I think Harden fits.
I'm just saying I think that Harden's going to shoot more than he'll ever pass. That's all I'm saying.
Well, he does that now.
Yeah, exactly. That's my point.
Oh, D'Antoni,
which is why you don't
D'Antoni think D'Antoni thinks that'll make the offense better.
And what is that? How's that work for D'Antoni?
Offensively, very
welcome
well.
Welcome to my
really?
Life. That'll do it for us, people. Okay. Make sure to catch First Take Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN2. Appreciate you hanging with us. Have a great night.